I'm Kwame Holman, here with Victoria Bassetti, who has written a book about the U.S. electoral system, its long history. Victoria, it's called Electoral Dysfunction. I take it from that title that you don't think that the system is as good as it can be.
No, I think America's ideals and philosophy and hopes for democracy are definitely about as good as we could hope them to be. But I think the way we actually administer our elections is not really a beacon for the rest of the world. I think, if 2 months from now a group of Martians were to land on the United States or land on Earth and say, and go to the United Nations and say, people of Earth, we've decided to become a democracy, who should we model it on? No one would raise their hand and say, take a look at the United States. They've got that system down perfectly.
You start with a historical look from the beginning of the founding of the Republic, and you find that there actually isn't a right to vote in the founding documents.
Yeah, it's one of the more startling things. When you sit down and read the Constitution as originally drafted in 1787, there's absolutely no mention whatsoever of the way the people are supposed to vote. There are a lot of reasons why that's the case. Part of it has to do with the necessary compromises that the founders had to make in order to get a Constitution adopted. In the late 18th century, every state had a different way of voting and had different groups of people who were allowed to vote. So the founders probably realized that if they had tried to impose universal suffrage, many of the states would have refused to ratify the Constitution. So they kind of skipped the issue and left the election system to the states in 1787.
You talked about in the book how freed slaves might have been granted suffrage, women might have been granted suffrage by some states, and rather than take that on,
yeah,
the founders stepped away.
Exactly. So free slaves or free people of color were allowed to vote in Massachusetts, in New York, but they obviously weren't allowed to vote in large swaths of the South, in South Carolina and Georgia. So was the new Congress, was the new government going to actually step in and tell South Carolina that black people were going to be able to vote? Or in contrast, were they going to step in and tell Massachusetts that black people were no longer going to be able to vote? It was an impossible thing for them to try to fix. In addition, the founders had some concerns about universal suffrage. At the time, obviously, only white men who were property owners mostly were allowed to vote. As you said, in some states, women were allowed to vote. For example, in New Jersey, although that was quickly repealed. In some states, blacks were allowed to vote, but there were also property requirements imposed upon them in most states. So they had a lot of questions or concerns about this kind of massive, uncontrolled, uneducated, unpropertied voters. What would they do? Would they run wild and would democracy run amok? They had those concerns, and they were definitely present in 1787.
Fast forward mm-hmm. to today, to maybe 2000, when the Bush-Gore election ended as it did. The situation was that there are 13,000 jurisdictions. The states have been running their own elections down to the county level and so forth. Is it as chaotic as it perhaps seems?
Well, you know, it's messy, and sometimes it's chaotic, and we're very often running a risk with every election. As long as our elections aren't close, they pretty much work. But once the election and once the microscope gets on each individual election, there's so much chaos and messiness in the system. And you look, no one ever said that moving 135 million or, you know, 150 million people to the polls all on one day into 13,000 different election districts was going to be easy. So it can be very messy. It can be very exuberant. It can be very chaotic. It can be frustrating. It can be a horrible experience for some people. So we get it right most of the time, but please don't let it be close.
Is there a better way to do it fundamentally?
Yeah. So to begin with, you know, in virtually every state, the people who administer the elections are partisans. They're members of one particular party or another. Now, many of them, probably the vast majority of them, take their responsibilities seriously and genuinely do not try to tip elections one way or another on the basis of their partisan affiliation. But it does happen, and there are many decisions that are made on a state, local, and county level all of the time that raise a flag and concern about partisan manipulation of the system. If we wanted to do a better system, we really could look to the north, to Canada, where they've imposed a uniform balloting system, a nationwide coherent voter registration system, and where they've got a nonpartisan election administration system in place. And some states in the United States have also attacked the problem and attempted to create nonpartisan or bipartisan administration of elections. Once you take that kind of partisan ire and partisan battle out of elections, I think people's faith and confidence in the election system in the United States will significantly go up. They won't be any longer concerned, sometimes with real reason, that the ballots aren't being counted, that people aren't being registered on the basis of their party affiliation.
What do you expect this election day, and do you think that the results will move closer to the kind of electoral utopia, not dysfunction, that you talk about?
Yeah, you know, the last time America tried to seriously tackle its election administration system was in the wake of 2000, and that was in the wake of a very nasty and ugly situation, which really uncovered a lot of the flaws in our system. It uncovered not only the flaws in the way we cast ballots and count ballots, but it also uncovered flaws in the Electoral College. It's a late 18th century relic, which really doesn't make a lot of sense to, you know, from a structural or theoretical perspective in America today. It creates situations where the man or the woman one day with the most popular votes may actually lose the election. And the last time that happened was in 2000, when Al Gore won the popular vote by more than 500,000 votes, but because of the functioning of the Electoral College, lost the presidency to George Bush. It's happened three other times in American history. So every time we have a presidential election, we're kind of playing with fire. We're running the risk that that outcome could occur again. And not only are we running that risk, but we're creating a kind of a structural system that skews the way presidential election campaigns are run, and that essentially pushes large numbers of states to the margins or to the edges in terms of their relevance to the presidential election. There is one initiative that's underway right now which seems to hold the most promise in recent memory, probably in the last 100 years, of actually having an effect, and that's called the National Popular Vote, which, rather than abolishing the Electoral College by constitutional amendment, seeks to kind of do an end run around the Electoral College. It is a interstate compact where each state that signs the compact commits to giving its Electoral College votes to the winner of the national election, not to the winner of the election in their particular state. So once enough states who have cumulatively 270 Electoral College votes, sign the compact, it will go into effect. At that point, whoever wins the national popular vote wins the election, regardless of how each individual state election turns out. A little complicated to explain, but if people want to learn more, I'm sure they can go on that initiative's website.
Very good. Victoria Bassetti, author of Electoral Dysfunction, thank you very much.
Thank you.